Gossip at the Corpse Cart contains graphic and explicit content that may not be suitable for some listeners. Listener discretion is advised.
Welcome back to the newest installment of Gossip at the Corpse Cart. Tell them. Where we, the wine and crime gals, talk about the shit you've seen on the internet by now.
Tell them about our friend's toddler and what she does when she sees the GAC logo.
Oh my God, yes.
Our illustration of the three of us next to a literal cart of corpses.
It's so cute.
She goes, that's Auntie Amanda, correctly. That's Elsa to Kenyon, and that's Anna to me. And then she goes,
Frozen.
And then she points to the corpse and goes, and that's that lady.
She asked, what's in the cart? So parenting is hard. It's like, how do you answer that question to a two-year-old?
It's a bunch of dead bodies.
Well,
with
when a man and a woman love each other very much, they inevitably die.
Murder each other. I forgot
for
to open
some
my white
reason.
Glove.
And they're piled into this cart, and then these three crazy ladies talk about
laugh
it
on, about it
on an online radio show. I'm looking at a picture of her right now in our we take a Renaissance photo every year, and she had, I think, one of the aunts handmade a little Renaissance like baby costume for
like
her.
Like a little jester outfit.
Oh, it's, my God. Send it right now to the chat.
It's so cute. I will.
You know I couldn't give a fuck about other people's children, but this particular child is the cutest being on the planet.
She's my favorite child, and I have nieces. And I know my sister is listening. I love them less. I just do.
Oh my God. Okay, well, that we'll save that for Coven Confessions.
No, it's out there. It's done.
In the meantime, let's get going with some crazy zany headlines from Amanda.
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh. Yes, I hope you're ready.
I never am.
I know. So this first headline is exactly what would happen if Kenyon had a gun.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
So just
not
prepare.
What anybody wants.
No, it's really not. There's also, this also technically isn't like a recent news story. It's from last year, and it's two sentences. So it's really great. Really great reporting out of Detroit, Michigan. God bless.
Also, we're not making fun of gun violence because as we record this, there was yet another fucking deadly mass shooting, and this country is so fucking fucked, and I'm so upset about it.
Yes.
At this rate, there will be two more by the time this episode even comes out.
Take your pick about which mass shooting we're talking about.
This is America getting back to normal, and the shooting that we are referring to is the one in Boulder, Colorado, at the grocery store. There's been a lot of chatter about the perpetrator of that shooting, and a lot of, like, challenging conversation because this individual is Muslim, but he was white passing. And so there are a lot of, like, challenging conversations around race. So I just, you know, hopefully we can remind everybody that the Black community and communities of color get to grieve this situation and be frustrated with this situation. And that doesn't devalue the tragedy or the space we're holding for the victims of this shooting. That it's still, like, a serious problem. And this is also on the heels of the massacre in Atlanta.
Yeah.
Primarily targeting Asian women.
Yep.
So these are all of these conversations. Everybody wants to be like, why is everything about race? It's like, surprise, because it is.
Because it's everything America. Is about race.
Yeah. So
in this fucking country it is.
Yeah. So maybe instead of asking that question, get on board with your anti-racism journey. And that is my soapbox moment. And now we're going to have fun.
Okay. Sorry, I just had to bring it up because guns.
No, I'm glad that you did. I'm glad that you did, because it's important that we are addressing that. And obviously, we will likely address these issues in further detail in not a Gossip at the Corpse Cart episode.
Right.
But no, this is the first one that we're recording since both of these absolute fucked up tragedies have occurred. And that's my personal take on it in the Cliff Notes version.
Yeah.
But this is not that. This is a gun owner who made mistakes and took it out only on himself, which is like, fine by me.
All right.
If you're going to fuck up with a gun, at least you're not hurting somebody else, you moron.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
The headline reads, man shot himself in the foot after throwing shoe at a cockroach.
Oh my God, that would be me.
What? Yes. So he took his shoe off and chucked it at a cockroach and then went for his gun.
The cockroach?
I believe to shoot the cockroach.
No.
Oh my.
That is Kenyon.
Or
Kenyon loves killing bugs in a really dramatic fashion.
I know.
I know. I do. I don't take any chances.
No. But maybe this is not the chance you should.
I would not shoot a bug.
Yeah, no. So
that's my line.
Maybe a huge spider.
Yeah. Hashtag bug fact.
Hashtag bug facts. I would not shoot a bug. There's not a whole lot I understand about this, and that's because this is two sentences long. A Michigan man ended up with a bullet wound in his foot after police say he threw his shoe at a cockroach. The police said the man had his revolver inside the shoe.
There we go.
When he threw it at the bug. Police said the gun fell out of his shoe, discharged, and hit him in the foot. Which makes me question, was it actually a revolver or was it just a handgun? Because a revolver is really fucking hard to accidentally shoot.
I have no idea. And also, I'm guessing the safety wasn't on if that type of gun has a safety. I know nothing about guns.
I guess it depends
on... And I don't care.
Right.
I don't care to know anything about guns. I don't give a shit what AR in AR-15 stands for. Don't give a rat's ass.
Oh my God, Bill and I just had like a screaming to but not at each other and like scream agreeing conversation in the kitchen this morning. You've all had those conversations.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Where exactly that came up. Like, I don't know, some asshole was on some asshole Facebook thread was like, AR-15s aren't assault rifles. And it's like, just because the A stands for automatic doesn't mean it wasn't built to take down human beings.
Yeah.
Like, no fucking person, just random citizen, needs an AR. Like, you just fucking don't. And it's not for hunting. I don't care. I've shot them at the gun range. They're fun to shoot. Would never fucking own one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know what else is probably fun? Like pressing the red button to like launch a nuke. That'd probably be really fun.
That's a thrill.
Driving a fucking tank would probably be very exhilarating.
Mm-hmm.
Am I gonna do it?
Hard no.
Sorry. I'm really riled up and I only had half a mimosa.
I love that this two sentence cockroach accidental foot shooting has launched all of our insanity and anger.
I'm playing Animal Crossing to balance your shit out.
Soothe yourself. I'll move on because that's literally the whole article. So don't, if you need to throw your shoe at a bug, make sure it's not the shoe that you're storing your revolver
in.
Don't store a gun in a shoe.
In your shoe.
Should be locked up and unloaded.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Ugh, so dumb. Okay. Next headline. And this is exactly the kind of parent that I would be. And I also can't promise that I won't ever do this for my nieces and just to piss off my sister. So.
The nieces you hate.
I don't hate them. I just love them less than my goddaughter. I think that's fair.
That's fair.
I'm sure it'll balance out at some point. My goddaughter will get to the point where she's not as cute anymore. And my nieces have just already grown into that phase. They're just less cute.
It's an age thing.
It totally is.
Yeah.
It's not my fault.
I don't know. Ruby's really fucking cute.
I know. And I shouldn't say I love them less. That was more for comedy drama. I like them less. Currently. But that is subject to change. Anyway, back to this story. The headline reads, Man stole 400-pound slide from a playground, mounted it on bunk bed. I'm sorry.
Wait.
Father of the year, IMO. A man is facing charges after he allegedly stole a 400-pound slide from a playground and mounted it on a bunk bed in his home. Dustin Allen Bushnell, 30, of Burbank, Washington, arrested Tuesday on a charge of possession of stolen property. Detective Julie Lee was investigating a series of catalytic converter thefts when evidence led her to Bushnell's home.
He's also stealing other shit.
Yeah, I love that he got caught because of the catalytic converter issue, not because of the
giant slide. Yeah.
There's like a rash of catalytic converter thefts around the country right now.
Everywhere.
It's very bizarre.
Yeah.
I caught someone doing that once.
To your car?
Someone else's car. I didn't stop them, but I did catch them doing it.
Saw someone doing it. Catching kind of alludes to like apprehension
I did apprehend. I went over. I assumed it was his car. And I went over and I said, "Do you need some help?" And he didn't see me coming.
"Do you want me to take a picture of you and the catalytic converter together?"
He was "No, I'm good." And he was like real sketchy about it. And I was like, "Okay, well, just let me know.
I'm an expert."
So really,
literally caught him stealing it, and then I didn't really register what was happening at the time.
That's a very different story than the one that you first started to tell.
I do almost him doing it.
No.
I did apprehend him. It was just in a really friendly way.
You didn't.
Didn't apprehend
you almost
him.
Took part.
You offered to assist.
Yeah, whatever. You didn't catch someone doing it. You almost did it.
In fact, I think we could charge you with like aiding and abetting at this point.
Whatever.
I really love the idea of you offering to take a picture of the guy and the catalytic converter together.
I should have. I really should have.
Anyway, so Detective Lee goes to this house about the catalytic converter. She suddenly came face to face with the gigantic slide, which was reported stolen in December of 2020, as she searched the home for catalytic converters. Bushnell sawed off the slide, repainted it.
Oh,
what?
And mounted it on a bunk bed.
Is it a rifle?
I know, right? And mounted it on a bunk bed in a child's bedroom at his mobile home, according to investigators. Catalytic converters were also found at the home. But Bushnell has not yet been charged with stealing the car parts. An investigation remains ongoing.
Hey, he's an involved father.
I love it.
What
personally.
Child's bunk bed has a weight capacity of at least 400 pounds?
Well, the entire 400 pounds wouldn't be on the bunk bed.
It would
There's a picture on the
tip
drive.
It over, though, if it was that heavy.
Maybe it was anchored to the wall.
Anchored to the wall, yeah.
Oh,
you can see a picture on the drive. And it looks like this bunk bed is made of metal. Mm-hmm. So I think it's fine.
He doesn't look like he has great eyesight.
Probably not, but that's neither here nor there. God bless him.
Both here and there, according to his eyes.
Oh, God. Oh, no. Moving on.
That slide looks fun as fuck. I want that slide.
It does. I know. I'm like father of the year for real. All right. I have a few more. This next one is just, these are just my favorite kinds of Florida stories. I just, Floridaman strikes again.
Mm-hmm. Floridaman.
So, Floridaman arrested for tossing gator into a Wendy's.
Oh.
Just what? Toss it and leave it. Gators are pests.
Gators are pests.
He was done with it.
So this is from Jupiter, Florida, which just sounds terrible. A Jupiter, Florida man Jupiter, Florida is quite beautiful, and I only know this because Tyler from a previous season of The Bachelorette is from there. And so I've
Isn't that where our friend Shathrin lives?
Oh, possibly.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah, come forward if it's you. So a Jupiter, Florida man was arrested for throwing a live alligator into a Wendy's restaurant drive-thru window.
No, that's not the same as just into a Wendy's.
East of Loxahatchee.
That's what I was picturing, was the drive-thru window.
I was picturing him walking in, sliding the gator across the floor.
I was picturing like the vestibule at most.
Mm.
Okay, this gets sad. Just a friendly reminder, I don't read these articles. I only read the headline. If it makes me laugh, I include it. Mm-hmm. And then I always get into this situation where I start reading it and I'm like, oh, this is sad.
Oh, you haven't even read it yet?
No, I always cold read it. It's more fun because then my reaction is authentic.
Uh-oh.
So Joshua James, 23, was charged with aggravated assault with a deadly weapon, which either is a gun or maybe the alligator. Mm-hmm. But he was also charged with illegally killing, possessing, or capturing an alligator. So, okay, maybe he didn't kill it. He just possessed/captured it.
Yeah, right. He kidnapped it.
Alligators are a dime a dozen down there, so
they're pests.
He probably just picked it up from the roadside.
Almost did. And excuse me, sorry. I got my COVID vaccine today. Yay, so did Lucy.
Me too.
And I have very minimal side effects, but one of them is like a very sore throat.
Yeah.
And it sort of feels like I have that weird like back of the throat congestion, like you're about to get a cold. Mm-hmm. So if I'm like hacking mm-hmm. and clearing my throat, this is why, but I'm fine.
It's for science and it's worth it.
Yeah. Anyway, he also got a second degree larceny. Is this petty or petite theft? Are those different? Because it's spelled petite.
It's probably supposed to be petty. But I don't think it's spelled petite theft.
Why is that so funny to me?
It wasn't a big deal.
Here in Jupiter, Florida, we call it petite theft. It's just not as big of a deal.
I never click on the article.
Did you see it?
Yeah, it is. It's petite. Yeah.
It's spelled petite. We're only calling it petite theft now. Petite larceny is going to be my new drag name.
Petite larceny.
That's actually perfect.
Right? I'm short. Okay. He has not been released on bail as of Monday afternoon. WPTV reports that the incident occurred in October.
PETIT news report.
WPTV. That the incident occurred in October, but James had only been arrested recently by U.S. Marshals. Oh, he evaded capture. Officials with Florida
They had something they had to deal with.
I guess.
Before they could call the cops. They had a lot on their hands.
So clear. They were busy. Officials with Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission told Petite TV that James pulled up for his order. Okay, so he placed an order. I love that. And after a server handed him a drink and turned around, James tossed the 3.5-foot gator into the drive-thru window.
Ah, poor gator. Owie.
I know. But also, like, dumb, wait till you get all your food. Like, if the point is... Mm-hmm. I don't want to pay for this.
Oh, is that the point?
I thought the article ends.
It sounds like a prank. It was intent. Who drives around with a fucking gator and then decides to get pissed off and chuck the gator at someone?
Floridaman. We've covered stories like this before where they just have lizards in their car.
Yeah.
Trying to track logic is just not effective.
Not with Floridaman.
In these kinds of stories. Not for Floridaman.
Mm-hmm. Florida man.
So I have no idea if that alligator's okay. I'm assuming a 3.5-foot alligator can handle a little slide into a drive-through window, but hopefully it sounds like all this guy got out of it was a free soda, which like those cost like 3 cents anyway.
That has to have been a prank.
Maybe. I want to know what he ordered.
He probably ordered gator bats, and they were like, "We don't carry gator bats." And he's like, "Now you do."
I don't think even a Florida Wendy's carries gator bats. minutes.
Maybe the softy machine was broken.
It's always broken.
It's always fucking broken. Lucy and I are always mad about that. Okay, well.
It's because they're fucking filthy inside.
I don't care.
We shouldn't be consuming that liquid.
Honestly, the grosser the restaurant, the better the food tastes, always. It's just that's how it is. And unless there's like one time where that's not true, but 90% of the time.
My restaurant.
Right.
Yeah, okay. Bristles.
No, your restaurant is clean and delicious, but that's rare. Let me tell you.
I don't disagree with you. Right. I'll do my best to keep it that way. My own restaurant.
That'd be great. Okay, this next one is a doozy. Everyone obviously knows that I love to vacation with family every year on the Jersey Shore. Mm-hmm. And all of us on those trips have had encounters with aggressive seagulls. Mm-hmm. So this really spoke to me. Not from the Jersey Shore, but this happened. Edinburgh woman bit off man's tongue in street brawl before seagull swooped down and ate it.
Ooh. Oh, that is the most Scottish ass thing I've ever heard.
Bit off a whole tongue?
A chunk. So a man who had a large chunk of his tongue bitten off by a female thug. And there's a picture of her on the drive. Oh. She's a Karen. Was left horrified when a seagull swooped down and ate it. James McKenzie spat out a piece of his tongue onto the street after Bethany Ryan, 27, had ripped it off with her teeth during an incident in Edinburgh.
He probably fucking deserved it.
I have no notes on this entire thing. The gull got what the gull needed.
Oh, man.
Bethany and James hopefully settled their dispute. Oh. Hopefully we find out what the dispute was. The gull then flew down and grabbed the muscle, making off before the injured man could retrieve it.
Ew.
Oh, I was mid-drink when you said muscle.
The muscle. Edinburgh Sheriff Court was told about the grisly incident, which left the victim maimed for life when Ryan appeared on the dock to plead guilty to the attack last Thursday. In a tweet from Edinburgh Evening News, "Sometimes it's easier for us to come to you with the news. Our free email newsletter delivered a snapshot of the biggest..." Wait, why is this? This is not what this is about. That was an ad. Wow.
How's that cold read going for you?
Well, it's very annoying because a lot of times these articles will have like really funny tweets in them. And that wasn't a funny tweet.
That was definitely an advertisement.
But it is a tweet. If you look at it, it's a tweet for the Edinburgh News embedded in the article. See where I would get the feeling that it's related to the fucking article. I'm writing an email after this. Very upset.
Moving on. Like you can just reply to that tweet.
I've got to. Oh, that's smart. I'm going to open this tweet in a new window so I can save it to complain. Open a new tab. Okay. Prosecutor Susan Dixon said the pair clashed as they passed each other on Leith Walk at around 8 p.m. on August 1st, 2019. So this is another one that's from a while ago, but I don't read this shit. Ms. Dixon said the pair were strangers, but an argument developed between them.
Yeah, he probably catcalled her or some shit, and she wasn't having it.
It's possible, but let's see. The court heard Ryan had tried to walk away from the confrontation. The fiscal said McKenzie continued to be aggressive towards Ryan and he approached her again with a clenched fist.
Oh, yeah.
Ms. Dixon said Ms. Ryan somewhat oddly responded to that by pushing him on the body and kissing him. It was probably her fault. I'm going to just go with it. She kissed him on the lips, and during the course of that, she bit through his tongue, which caused a piece of his tongue to be removed. Mr. McKenzie walked off and spat a part of his tongue out, at which point the piece of muscle was picked up by a large seagull that made off with the tongue.
That's not great. You know what? That is awful, and we don't know the full story, but if someone fucking aggressively catcalls me, I'm doing this to them when COVID's over. I'm just gonna rush at them and try to aggressively kiss them on the mouth and then bite their tongue off.
That is all sorts of harassment.
It's very weird. So
they started it.
I don't know.
They started it, she says quietly.
So this Bethany Ryan person was later arrested by police, and Mackenzie, the victim of the tongue removal, attended hospital for treatment where the laceration to his tongue was said to be oozing blood.
Nope.
The fiscal added he did not require surgery given the piece of tongue was no longer available and could not be reattached.
Oh, God.
Solicitor Neil Martin, defending, said the attack by his client of Lockend, Edinburgh, was, quote, a very strange incident in the round. But he added he would reserve his full mitigation to the sentencing hearing. Sheriff Nigel Ross said because of the serious nature of the incident, he needed to defer sentence for the perpetration of reports to later this year. So we might not know yet what the full story is. Mm-hmm. This could be ongoing.
Mm-hmm.
Ryan pleaded guilty to assaulting James Mackenzie by pushing him on the body, kissing him and biting off part of his tongue to his severe injury and permanent disfigurement at Leith Walk, Edinburgh on August 1st, 2019.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so, permanent disfigurement is never fun.
No.
No. But
she also, I'm not convinced that she didn't start this. I'm going to be honest.
Maybe.
Just
we
looking
don't have
at
enough.
Her blurred out face and her very, very ugly scarf.
Oh, yeah.
I'm just, my trust, I could see her yelling at like the manager of a McDonald's.
Yeah.
If there's just something about her body language. I can't see her face, but I don't like the gal.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, moving on. I have two more. This next one is exactly why my days of camping without plumbing ended in my 20s.
Oh, yeah.
No more of that. Haines woman braves bare bottom brush with black bear.
Oh.
Ooh.
Yeah. A group of Haines residents had a bizarre encounter with a bear near Chilcot Lake on Saturday. Shannon Stevens said she was using an outhouse when she felt something bite her bottom.
No.
Yeah.
Well, the black bear was there first.
Quite literally. So Shannon Stevens spent the weekend with her brother and his girlfriend at a remote yurt on Chilcot Lake, 17 miles from Haines. After traveling across the frozen lake by snow machine. This is already way more intense outdoor sporting
yeah, that's
than
like
I would.
Remote.
Yeah. If I have to cross a lake on a snowmobile, which I do love snowmobiling, don't get me wrong, but if that is the only means to access the site on yeah. which you want me to camp.
Yeah, no, I would.
Sir.
I would be into snowmobiling, but I want to keep civilization always within sight.
Oh, yeah. And to know that I'm going to be driving back to a cabin with a flushing toilet and uh-huh. a lot of wine and a roaring fire.
Yeah.
Those are the
I need
terms.
Hot running water.
Yeah. I want to take a bath after a day of snowmobiling.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I want him to look like he just came in from snowmobiling. You know, rosy cheeks, a little red on the nose.
Red nose and mouth.
Okay, so, quote, normally when we're out there in the summer or fall, I'm used to shouting, hey, bear, the whole way.
Yeah. Oh.
It was the dead of winter, so I didn't think to do that this time because, you know, they're hibernating.
Mm.
I got in there and sat down on the toilet seat and something just immediately bit me in the butt. I jumped up and screamed.
Yeah.
She called for her brother, Eric Stevens, which is funny because yeah. we have a friend, Eric Stevens, from our high school who definitely listens to this podcast.
Hey.
Hello, Eric Stevens. I hope this was you because I want more details. Who came running to investigate. Quote, I'm like, okay, I'm going to open the lid and look. I take the headlamp and I grab the lid of the toilet seat and I lift it up. And right at the level of the toilet seat, maybe an inch or two below, is a gigantic bear face
in
looking
the pool?
Right back up at me. Yes.
Yeah. Oh.
In the latrine.
Oh,
whole
no.
new meaning to honeypot, am I right?
Oh, boy. Oh,
why, would a bear go in the latrine?
It's
probably
mean,
warm.
It's warm and it's like a little den that he didn't have to build. You caught him snoozing.
Oh, God, what a nightmare. I'm sure everybody has this, but I have such anxiety about sitting on a toilet and there being a snake.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah. Or it's those, like...
What? Like a regular toilet here?
Yes.
Well, it started in South Africa where, like, it actually does happen to
oh,
people.
Yeah. That doesn't happen here, though.
Yeah. I mean, here meaning in like Iowa and Kentucky. I think it has happened in Florida, but everything has.
Yeah, or California, probably. I don't know.
But like city infrastructure wise, I don't know how a snake could get up in there.
We had plumbing issues at an old shitty apartment that I lived in an old house, and a fucking plumber came and dislodged a dead rat. That had a snake still attached to it that had been trying to eat it, and they both died in a pipe in our building.
Oh.
They pulled that out of a plumbing pipe in our building.
That's absolutely abnormal.
Yeah. It's not common, but it does happen. Mm-hmm. But I never saw one in the toilet or anything. We were just like, why doesn't anything drain?
You should be more afraid of an animal existing like up under the rim of the toilet seat, not like the coming spiders out from the toilet.
Oh, spiders in Australia where like you see those videos, they flush and then like a giant scrambling spider is like running to try not to go down
that
the toilet.
Happened. In China, I checked the toilet seat every fucking time.
No.
Frequently, there were huge fucking spiders.
You guys have seen my photo of the spider in India that was on my toilet in my bedroom, and it was the size of a dinner plate, and I have a photo.
Oh, yeah.
No.
And I saw it because in the middle of the night, I got up to pee, and I opened the door to my bathroom, and thank God I turned on the light, and I saw it. Otherwise, it would have been directly behind me while I sat on the toilet.
So what did you do?
I was
renting. She shot it.
I threw my shoe at it and that happened to have my revolver in it. Cocked and ready to go.
I was renting a room from like a very elderly widowed lady at the time, so I didn't want to wake her up by like screaming uncontrollably. So
I would not have cared about her feelings in that moment.
So I shut the door. I like backed away and like shut the door, and then I shoved a bunch of towels under the
seal.
Door.
Make a seal.
Yeah.
Where'd you pee?
I didn't. And then I stayed up all night. I could not sleep at all night. And then
I would have peed in the sink, I think.
Yeah.
No, the sink was in the bathroom.
Oh, God.
The ones in China, like, charged you. Like, chased.
Yeah.
I've been chased by a spider in China. That's not good.
Mm-hmm. Don't like
that. I'll try to find that photo. So
oh,
we
good.
Can
you work on that.
Include it on the drive.
while I finish.
It was literally the size of a plate.
Great. While I finish this nightmare, you go dig up that one for me.
I'll find my big one too.
Great. Continuing on, Eric Stevens. He closed the lid and they ran back to the yurt as fast as they could. Shannon Stevens was bleeding, so they cleaned the wound and bandaged it up. She said she was shocked, but not seriously injured. Got bitten by a bear here once, would go back.
On her ass, too. Yeah. And then she had to snowmobile back to civilization on her bear-bitten ass.
After her brother had to treat her ass wound. That is a close-knit family. Quote, it felt like just a single puncture. Maybe it wasn't even a bite. It might have been a swipe with his claw, potentially. I don't think we'll ever really know that part, Shannon said.
Yeah.
They stayed in the yurt the rest of the night and waited till morning to take a look around. The next day, the bear was gone. The fire pit had been knocked over and there were tracks running toward the house. And there is a photo, I'll put it on the drive, of Eric took a picture of the tracks of the bear compared to like his hand for scale. So you can get an idea of how big this fucker was. I just uploaded it to the drive. So if you do a refresh, you'll be able to see it. Like, this bear was no joke.
Oh, no.
Big boy.
Oh, God.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Eric says he believes the bear was attracted by the smell of cooking, then entered the hole below the outhouse through an opening downhill. Quote, there's a way out in the back of the outhouse. There's a rock wall, and there's a way for a creature to get in through that rock wall. He probably just pushed the rocks over and got down in the hole. But
so he
it
might
is Alaska,
not have been like covered in shit. He might have, you know, it was probably where they change out the septic tank or whatever. Mm-hmm.
Or whatever the catch tank is. Yeah. But maybe there isn't even one. Maybe just shit in a pit. I don't know. I have no clue.
I don't know. I don't know.
So that's that.
That's terrifying.
Yes. And my final one, this is the most submitted, including by Kenyon, to our text thread.
Yay!
I loved this. I figured everybody else would love this too. And they would, because a million people sent it to me and I am fucking here for it. The headline reads, Texas Wax Museum removes Trump figure because people keep punching it. this is from rare.us.
And Ted Cruz keeps trying to jerk it off.
Oh my God. Ted Cruz keeps sucking its wax dick.
Ew.
He's just, I love that Ted Cruz has like a year-long pass to Madame Tussauds just so we can like suck wax Donald Trump's dong. Why would
make,
I not
make eyes at him?
He probably has this wax figure in his house now that it's not in this museum.
Mm-hmm.
I
probably
would
commissioned a duplicate.
Probably a nude of the two of them in a warm embrace.
I want it to look just like Lindsey Graham's.
His can't be better than mine. Okay, so the article begins, LOL, I love Texas. Everything about it, especially this. Turns out Louis Tussauds Waxworks on Alamo Plaza, located in San Antonio, decided to put away a wax figure of former President Donald Trump after visitors took out, let's say, 4 years' worth of frustrations on it. Louis Tussauds Waxworks is one of three Ripley's Believe It or Not attractions in the city. And I have to say, if you are ever in a city with a Tussauds Wax Museum or a Ripley's Believe It or Not, fucking go.
There's one in L.A.
Yep, and we went to that one. And I went to that one last year. We went to the one in Amsterdam. It was like the best.
Oh my God.
I love a wax museum.
There are both in Pigeon Forge near Dollywood, and we couldn't go because of COVID, but next time we go there, we're definitely going to go.
We're going. Mm-hmm. You know I love a wax museum.
Oh yeah.
I've been to the one on the Canadian side of Niagara Falls like 8 times. Mm-hmm. It never gets old. I love it. Anyway, that's my unpaid plug for wax museums in general. Continuing on, which usually
hashtag
serves
sponsored.
I'm emailing Madame Tussauds today to see if they want a spot.
They're like, no, how'd you get our number?
I've had
Stop
it for years.
Calling.
Me again. Oh,
hey, Madam,
okay.
It's Amanda. Hey. What's up, girl?
So something I didn't know, fun fact from this article, if you have heard of Madame Tussauds Wax Museum in London, well, Louis is actually her great-grandson. So it's a whole family business of waxing.
Wow.
Jesus Christ.
I wonder if they redo, like, Chairman Mao and Ho Chi Minh every year and,
maybe.
Like, Stalin.
I'm sure.
Don't dig too far into wax museum facts because I have it slated on the docket for a potential drunk dive.
I will not look into it any further than I already extensively have.
Please do cover, like, the wax-covered dictators, though, because apparently there's, like, a factory somewhere in Russia where they're taken to be redone every few years.
Oh, I love the sound of that. And also, when you first said dictators, my hungry ass
wax-covered dicks
thought that you were talking about dictators.
Dictator tots?
Yeah.
Yum.
Yeah, that sounds good.
I want tater tots. So although it is a very popular museum due to all of its celebrity and well-known wax figures, one figure has not been shown a lot of love in the past 4 years. A figure of former President Donald Trump was being displayed at the museum, but unfortunately is now in hiding. Apparently, the dummy of President
he's
Trump...
He's in the bunker.
He's in the fucking bunker of the Tussauds Wax Museum. God damn it. Has suffered damage from both punches and scratches to its face. According to the assistant to the regional manager for the museum, Clay Stewart, quote, when it's a highly political figure, attacks can be a problem. Mm-hmm. He also noted that with the limited space, they decide which figures they want to display based on how the popularity of the politician, star athlete, or celebrity has stood up over time. Mm-hmm. Apparently, Trump is now in good company sharing storage space with George Washington, W.C. Fields, and 30 other decommissioned wax figures.
W.C. Fields,
and
that's
Hitler.
Hysterical. People are so like, stupid. Who?
Right? This visitor's attack on the Trump wax figure increased during the 2020 presidential campaign. The company did try to move Trump to the lobby where the ticket attendants could keep an eye out for attackers and stop them, but people still kept taking their shots at the figure. This isn't the first time the company has had trouble with presidential wax figures. Stewart stated, quote, "We've always had trouble with the presidential section because no matter what president it was, Bush, Obama, or Trump, they've all had people beat them." The ears were torn off Obama 6 times, and Bush's nose was fully punched in. I love that. People are just aggressive about their political party, end quote.
It's true. So, that if that ain't America summed up.
I know. The jury is out on whether or not they will patch Trump up and roll his ass back out onto the floor, but it's unlikely that they will bring him back from hiding until the attraction receives a President Joe Biden figure, which is now being sculpted down in Florida.
Love it. Nice.
And those are my headlines this month.
What a good smattering. Nice.
Some doozies. We had animals. We had wax figures. We had
Florida man.
We had some idiot shooting himself in the foot. We had a poop bear.
Yeah.
This was rife with with topics. Mm-hmm. And as always, if you have an incredible headline to share, you can submit it via our website. On that Contact Us portal, there is a drop-down selection for funny headlines. Mm-hmm. And that will ensure that it gets into the right email folder. So please use that tool if you can.
Mm-hmm. Well, should we hear a word from our other sponsors now that wax museums have been plugged?
Yeah. Yes, please. If you've ever listened to our show...
Ever.
Hello, and thank you. But if you have, you know that we are in love with Rothy's, this company that makes stylish, sustainable shoes and bags and masks. Hello. They are carefully crafted with eco-friendly materials like repurposed plastic water bottles and marine plastic.
Gotta love that.
The best. Tell us more.
They're so stinking cute. This is not an exaggeration. I get compliments on them every time I wear them in public. Mm-hmm. And if somebody else is wearing them in public, I like give them a wink. I'm like, Rothy's.
I went to get my oil changed, used my Rothy's shoes, my Rothy's bag, and my Rothy's mask all in one outfit. It was a lot and amazing.
It's a complete outfit. Mm-hmm. Rothy's are available in a range of styles and come in an ever-changing array of colors, prints, and patterns. Every time I look at their website, I see something new and so stinking cute, and I have to get it. Refinery29 says that Rothy's are equal parts comfort and chic, and Health says that they're the most comfortable shoes on earth. And you know what, Health? You're right. Best part about Rothy's, they get a little dirty, a little funky. You just throw them in your washing machine. They come out good as new. It is
seriously
unbelievable. You will never look for, or you'll never find a better shoe than this. You might look, but you won't find it.
You'll look, but you won't succeed. I wore my Chelsea boots, my little ankle booties, to literally hike in Palo Duro Canyon State Park in Texas. And I stepped in some very, like, red clay mud that, like, I sunk into this mud puddle. I was not paying attention.
But washed you also my Rothy's. Didn't even break a sweat.
Didn't even break a sweat and was not worried that I just ruined a valuable pair of shoes. I just popped them in the laundry and it was, like, absolutely perfect. Wash them, air dry them, you would never have known. So check out all of the amazing shoes, bags, and masks available right now at rothys.com/gals. That's rothys.com, rothys.com/gals, G-A-L-S. Style and sustainability meet to create your new favorites. Head to rothys.com/gals today and treat your feet, your bod, your bag, everything.
Yeah, treat it all.
Treat it.
Nobody loves to get their period because you got your cramps, you're tired, you're cranky, and it's just, frankly, messy, not to mention wasteful, depending on the products that you're using. Sometimes I'm just not in the mood for a tampon because it makes my cramps bad. But guess what? You use a pad, it's just, everything is wasteful. There's just like not, I used to think there were just no good options out there. But turns out there is a very good option. If you want a period product that looks out for your body, your lifestyle, and the planet, you have got to try Flex.
Flex has changed my entire way of life. And we all know about, like, the pink tax and how, like, menstrual products are expensive. So Flex is innovating period care with products that are body safe, made for comfort, and made to keep you moving. So there are a couple different products that they offer. One is the Flex Disc, which is a one-time use menstrual disc that fits perfectly inside your body. And one Flex Disc can be worn for up to 12 hours and holds as much flow as three, you heard it, three super tampons.
That is remarkable.
It is remarkable. It is not a cup, and it is better than a tampon, better than a pad. It's unlike any other period product that you've seen before. It's literally like this little disc that has like a clear, you know, a black outer rim and then a clear kind of, you know, catch in the center. And it's very flexible, very easy to squeeze for insertion. You can wear it for mess-free period sex.
Hallelujah. Like
white sheets and period sex now can combine without fear. It's incredible. And Flex discs also create 60% less waste compared to pads and tampons. So if you still want to use a disposable product, consider using Flex for like your environmental good deed because it cuts down on waste so much. And if you want to go that extra step, you can get on board with what I've done. If you want to go zero waste and have the planet you love, like help it out even more, pick up the Flex Cup. This is their reusable menstrual cup that Cosmo rated number one. And I can see why. It is a patented design. It has a pull tab that makes Flex the only cup on the market that removes like a tampon. And that was huge for me. Like, I live in fear that I'm going to be fishing around in there and have no idea how to get it out because have anxiety.
It's like suctioned the to the inside of your body. Ugh.
But the Flex Cup takes care of that with that little, the pull tab. And it's the only cup on the market that removes that way. It's so easy. You already know how to use it. It is disability friendly and made with beginners in mind. I can't lie. The first couple times I tried to use a cup, I like couldn't get my fold right. I couldn't figure it out. I screamed and just threw it in the sink and was like frustrated. But the Flex Cup comes with this amazing packet inside the packaging that walks you through these different fold techniques. It's like really friendly and helps you stay encouraged to keep trying. You can also watch like YouTube videos that they put together on how to perfect your fold. It's amazing. It's velvety soft. It's completely body safe. It lasts for years. Years.
I'm so glad that you stuck with it and like learned how to do it the right way because you are like the biggest proponent of it now. I'm very proud of you.
Thank you. It's kind of bonkers. I like went on and texted all of my friends, sent everybody videos. I was so excited when I finally like got the hang of it. It's almost embarrassing, but exciting.
So say goodbye to cramps, put sex back on the table for the love. And lend Mother Nature a hand. Go to flexfits.com/gals, that's G-A-L-S, and use the promo code GALS for 20% off Flex Disc Starter Kits or 10% off your first Flex Cup, plus free shipping in the U.S. That's code GALS at flexfits, that's FLEXFITS.com/gals, and treat your period.
Treat it.
Are we ready for Coven Confessions?
Yes.
We have quite a good smattering this month as well. I'm just going to get right into it. So, quote, "The meanest thing I've ever done pales in comparison to most confessions, but it's still the worst thing I meant to do."
Ooh, okay. I really appreciate that there's a whole subgenre of, I didn't mean to do it, but it was really bad.
This is I meant to do it.
Yeah. Oh, I know.
Yeah. This is probably going to be a long story long. I hope you enjoy. It's actually not long. I hated my mom's husband, like really hated him. He said inappropriate things to my friends. He wouldn't let me have a cat.
Oh,
he was demeaning.
Send him away.
He was demeaning to my mom. He was awful. I love how it's like, that not letting you have a cat is like sandwiched between two
actually like, really terrible
like abusive stepdad things. I actively tried to piss him off. I became a vegetarian because he was a meat and potatoes guy. I got a kitten and made up a story to my mom about how I had to save her. I also did that, but my mom did not fall for it, and she didn't even let the kitten in the house.
Poor little bubby.
She's like, put it back.
Well, he always had to have a salad with dinner, and he liked tuna on his salad.
Mm.
One night, I was making his salad, and instead of tuna, I used cat food.
Ooh.
He ate it and never said a thing. I mean, like, flash news, like, cat food is basically just really low-quality tuna.
Unless it's not even tuna at all.
I don't know.
No, I feel like
you're not wrong.
Well, newsflash, yeah. Canned human tuna is just as bad as cat food. So
I love tuna. Kenyon hates it, and Lucy and I are like all about it.
I can't tuna be in melt. The same room as it.
Tuna melts are so
tuna melt
fucking good.
Is the special on Friday at Lachelle's.
Oh, I'm on my way.
God damn it, I got stung by these fucking wasps again.
So
in Animal Crossing, not in real life. Don't worry, she's fine.
Oh, okay. I didn't understand. I also okay. Now, fast forward a few years, and my mom divorced him. Woo, woo, woo. Then, fast forward about 10 years, and my mom tells me he's in jail for burning down his neighbor's place with her in it.
Oh.
Then,
sir.
2 weeks later, my mom super nonchalantly tells me that he stabbed her and then burned down the woman's home.
What?
So I fed cat food to a murderer.
And the woman was like nonchalant about it, like the ex,
the mom. Yeah.
Did the so we know the woman that was stabbed. Not that honestly, he's a monster either way. It doesn't really matter. Well, I don't know. And that's poor verbiage. But like, did she survive?
Well, this person says murderer. So it doesn't sound like it. This is all the information
the
that I have.
Fuck? Oh my God.
Please follow up. Sender,
please feed more cat food to this person.
Yeah, but also, well, like, if you have a partner and your kids really don't like them, and it's not just like
you're not my real dad, teenage bullshit,
right? Like, pay attention to that.
Mm-hmm.
My aunt was engaged to someone before she met her now husband, who is lovely and wonderful. She was engaged to somebody else when I was like 8. And I never liked him. He never did anything to me. Like, it wasn't.
He got the vibes.
Got the vibes. Didn't like him.
Bad vibes.
My mom asked me why once, like, why I didn't like him. And I said he treated me like a child. I was 8.
You're that such a bitch.
It's the most 8-year-old Kenyon shit I have. Well, he treated me like a child. You're 8.
It's the most Kenyan thing I've ever heard.
Not even in double digits. This is what happens, though, like when you child. Fucking grow up like around adults.
Right, right. Yeah. So I never liked him. And then, lo and behold, he broke up with my aunt, like, by gathering all his shit, moving out of their apartment in, like, the middle of the day while she was at work and leaving her a post-it note that says, we need to talk.
Okay.
They were engaged.
Yikes.
Real rude.
Yeah. So anyway, sayonara. She's got such a great husband now. Okay.
Yeah, he's good shit.
So next, confession. Quote, I have never told this story to anyone. But when I was younger, I think 6th grade, Y2K right after the world didn't end like I thought it would. I won a radio contest and got to choose a friend to go to a Christina Aguilera concert with backstage passes.
No.
Oh my Lord.
It was so exciting. We were going to get picked up in a limo and hang out with ex-Tina.
This is my ex-Dreama. Oh my God.
I have no idea why I did, but I decided to take a new friend of mine who just moved to my school from England, just a few miles from Peniston, I'm sure. She loved Extina, so this was like a dream, an Extrema come true for her. On the day of the concert, I got dressed so cute and went over to her house. Her mom was adorable, and I was just obsessed with their accents. As we waited for the limo, I remember looking through a Word Up magazine. Remember those?
Yes.
And I was honestly just so effing excited for this concert. Obviously, something went horribly wrong for me to be submitting this confession
to
you.
Yeah, I'm like, how is this bad?
This is not the best night of your life?
We waited for the limo for hours, and I stayed outside with her and her mom just waiting for the limo to arrive. We were all so confused and frantic. I mean, how unprofessional of the radio station. I legit cried at the fear of missing this concert, knowing damn well that limo was never coming because I had made the whole thing up.
I knew it was too good to be true, you ex-Tina bitch.
This didn't happen to me, and I am so offended.
I'm kind of upset about this.
I am angry.
I did not see this twist coming. This shamo.
We got shamoed, and shamo'd. I am pissed about it.
I have no idea how I let this lie go so far, but I must have started believing my own lie. I was making fake calls to Extina's people, repeating the address to absolutely no one on the phone.
Oh.
Me calling the wax museum. I'm really, really connecting to a lot of moments in this story.
I couldn't believe I was in so deep, but in a situation like this, you have no choice but to follow through.
I don't know about that.
So when I realized there was no genie in a bottle showing up to save me, I had to do the right thing. So naturally, I waited until I, quote, got a call that they couldn't find the house. And Christina was going to be late for the concert, so we missed the opportunity. My friend's mom even ended up calling the radio station to complain about the way they treated us.
No. Oh, my God. The
XT,
lie.
No.
The lie went so far. It went so far.
To make matters worse.
Worse? How?
I hadn't even waited until there was an actual concert in town. So stop. I'm sure she eventually figured it out.
Oh.
I wouldn't know, though, because I never spoke to them again.
Oh.
Wow.
So you just completely trolled the new girl to school.
You shattered her heart.
You were going to be like her first friend. This is bad.
She moved back to England. The mom was like, no, we're out.
Right? This might be the worst one.
Oh, I think it's so funny.
It's perfect. Also, this is a total Amanda move. When I was in like seventh grade or sixth grade, I was definitely getting like a D in one of my classes. I think it was geography or something stupid that nobody fucking needs in adulthood. And I had been
geography.
Like,
geography.
Who fucking
pretty
needs
useful.
It? I have an iPhone. I don't need any of that shit.
Oh.
Maybe I didn't know it. I would have one of those then, but I certainly didn't care enough and have not needed it now. I cannot tell you where all 50 states are, and I don't need to because I have a map in my hand.
You didn't know where Iowa was for a while.
When?
Like
that's
when we were
true.
In high
seventh
school.
Grade.
No.
Like when we were in middle or high school and you knew that I went down to Iowa every summer for Sturgis Falls. And you're like, why'd you go that far? I don't know. You said something stupid. I was like, Iowa is next door to Minnesota.
First of all, it's downstairs to Minnesota. So do you know where Iowa is? Second of all, I've driven to Iowa many times. It is far. So I stand by my stupid comment. But anyway, irregardless, which has been added to the dictionary now.
No.
Yeah, it has. So I was like failing this class or getting a D or something that's not good. And I had been like intercepting letters home that are like, figure out your kid. They are failing geography.
I intercepted so many of those
letters. And then we get to like parent teacher conferences and like my parents are not dumb. So they like they know me. So they're before we go,
they know
they're
your
like,
shit.
Oh, they know my shit.
They did not fail geography.
No, they knew me. They were like, is there anything you want to tell us before we go into tonight?
No.
Is there anything that we should know? in that way Karen, where I, in my head, I'm going, oh, they are so fooled. I'm not going to say shit. And in their
Karen
head, they're
teacher
going,
conference
oh, this
night.
Girl is so screwed and we're going to give her a chance to confess. And right. we know what's happening.
Right. Totally. And they already know that you're not going to confess. So they're all,
no.
they're eager for your like ultimate punishment. Also,
oh, yeah.
parent teacher night, still like,
oh, anxiety dreams.
I still have anxiety about it now.
The worst.
Like, even just talking about it.
So, of course, I was like, no, I don't have anything to tell you. And then just assumed that, like, it wouldn't come up in the conference with that teacher that I was failing that class. And I just sat there quietly while he was like, we need to talk. And then I got very grounded and an earful from my parents on the way home.
They gave you the out. They really know you.
Oh, yeah. They knew exactly what was going on.
Oh,
but,
so funny.
You know, as I said to my little friend across the street when I was like 7, just lie. That's what I always do. Told him
you're
that as we were.
You're a psychopath.
I'm a psychopath. We were covering his dresser with Vaseline to make it shiny. And he was like, what if we get caught? And I said, just lie. That's what I always do. And his mother was listening through the door. Oh, I can't believe she let us continue to be friends.
Oh, God.
Can you imagine hearing that as the parent? I would have wet my pants.
I don't know how she kept her shit
just
together.
Lie.
And didn't burst
That's
into
what
the room.
I always do.
Just lie. That's what I always do. She immediately told my mother.
Oh, it's yeah.
The best. I'm going to text your mom right now and tell her.
Go for it. Just lie.
Oh, my God. All right.
And that advice holds up, by the way.
It's always worth a shot.
I live by that advice.
Jesus.
Okay.
It has gotten me very far.
So this next one is actually serious. So we're going to take a little turn. Then we're going to pick it back up with some funnies. But
great.
Gotta have one serious one, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, quote. I have to start this off by saying it's not the worst thing I've ever done, but I've never told anyone this story.
Okay.
It's something that I remember from time to time and kind of half smile, half cringe.
Ooh.
It happened when I was 12 years old with my older brother, Ethan, who is 4 years older than me. So he is 16 at the time.
Uh-oh.
My brother physically is a teddy bear. He wasn't like fat by any means. He was just a big and tall dude that looks like he could play rugby. The best part is he doesn't do that.
He doesn't play rugby?
Yeah, I guess.
That's the best part?
I don't know.
Okay.
My brother is an introvert with an aerospace engineering degree. Ethan finds comfort in his own home and could spend days not leaving the house with no problem. Well, guess what, Ethan? 2020 was your year, buddy.
Yeah. Come hang out. You can sit right by me.
I get it, Ethan.
As long as you're vaccinated.
He's just that kind of guy. Now, I know that 2/3 of the country does that already at this point in time, but it's Ethan's moment right now and he is thriving. Completely opposite of me. I need weed, going on hikes, and playing the sports balls with friends. You can do two of those things.
I can relate with one of those things. Yeah.
Anyways, back to the subject. One night, I'm laying in bed scrolling through probably Vine.
Oh, R.I.P.
When my brother knocks and asks to come in. He sounds all weird and guilty, and he sits on the bed and grabs my hand with this... I don't like this part. With his ridiculously soft PC gamer hands. And starts to apologize for being an asshole to me as kids. That's what siblings do, dog. And then venting about how girls don't like him or find him attractive at school. And I'm like, those hoes, who cares? Just wait till college. That's the good stuff. You know, just pumping him up.
Oh, God.
Like a good little sister. He asked me if he can ask me a question. Never a good sign.
Uh-oh.
I don't like where this is going at all.
No, I told you it's not funny. It's serious. Sure. At this point, I'm thinking, has he just been messing with me? Is he going to ask me to do his part of the chores or some shit? Nope, not that. He proceeds to ask me if he can touch my boob.
No.
What?
No. The answer is no.
Sir, you're incest.
Good Lord.
The writer says, what? What do I make of that? Grasp my A-cup boob? Question mark.
Well, that's not the biggest problem here.
I just sat up and was like, listen, you're going to find a girl one day that wants you to touch her boob, so no.
I'm not her. I'm your sister.
He apologized profusely, and then he scurried his ass back up the stairs. What the fuck? Now, granted, brothers are fucking weird. I've walked in on my younger brother only by 10 months trying on my bathing suits. And also opening up a used pad from the trash can because he thought it was candy from the pink wrapper.
I mean, sure. These are just dumb things that kids do.
Right. Right. But like, huh? I didn't know what to think about Ethan. Is my brother a fucking idiot? Am I a victim? Was he just soups horny or something? What the actual fuck? Anyways, that's pretty much the end of my story. My brother asked if he could touch my boob. I said no. He went back upstairs. I've never had another weird encounter with him like that since, and he's never brought it up. It was just a strange encounter that I know could be seen as very bad, but that was almost a decade ago. It felt good to type out. Even if you don't read it, that's perfectly fine. I find humor in it. Thanks for existing and making all of our lives better for it. So, yeah.
I don't know how to tackle that one.
I don't have a brother, and I did, like, Ashley and I did plenty of, like, dumb shit, but nothing sexualized like that.
Look, I only have a sister, so nothing like that ever happened, so no. I can't speak from personal, but that doesn't strike me as a functional brother-sister relationship.
As a normal request of your little sister.
I don't think it's normal. I also, like, you know, what is normal? But I think I'm glad that it only happened once.
Right. It didn't escalate.
And then he didn't force anything.
Right. Yeah.
The age difference bothers me.
Well, the fact that at the time of this, he was 16, it's like, you know, it's not the same as like a little kid when you're like trying to figure out what your parts are, and maybe you have a sister and it's like, well, what are these? I want to grab that. Like, that's a different situation.
But right. That said, we acknowledge all the time that your brain isn't fully developed until like your mid-20s. So there's that.
Sure.
But at 16, I would think that a person would know better.
I think that I'm glad that it helped you to type it out. I think it might even emotionally help you to talk about it with a professional who is not
any of us.
Any of us drinking mimosas and just talking out of our assholes right now.
Yeah, I think that's super fair, because, like, I mean, I certainly have had sexual experiences, not with a sibling, but in my life, where I just, like, didn't process what happened and kind of just wrote it off as, like, bad sex.
Yeah, right. After and the then, fact, you're like,
Yeah, it took a really long time, and quite frankly, like, hearing a lot of other people's stories in the, like, influx of the Me Too movement to be like, oh, shit.
Right.
I was actually sexually assaulted, and I didn't even realize, like, that's not how my brain processed it. And
at that time.
Yeah, and it was hard, but it helped me a lot to reshape those experiences and, like, understand better.
And it might even, you know, if you did talk to a therapist about this, they might have tools for you to eventually talk with your brother about it. And it could be something that he really needs to talk about with someone. Yeah. You know,
there's no shame to this writer on this writer's behalf in this whole situation.
No,
I don't think
you
should feel any shame whatsoever.
Right.
But also, probably wasn't the healthiest encounter. I would encourage you to maybe think about talking to somebody else about this.
Yeah. Yeah. So you know, every once in a while, we got to have some serious ones in there, because it's Coven Confessions.
Oh, yeah.
All right. We've got three more, but two are very short.
My last follow up with that, I appreciate that sender for sharing, because I'm sure you're not alone out there.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
We appreciate you sharing and opening up this dialogue.
Absolutely, yeah. And I don't have siblings, so I have got nothing to, I have no reference point. But yeah, especially with, like, there's so much, like, incest-themed porn out there. Mm-hmm. And which is bizarre. I think it's because it's like one of the last big taboos.
Sure.
And so porn that used to be like, no, you can't, I'm married, or like, mm-hmm. no, we can't, we're from two different castes in society. Now
we have
it's
to
like,
sleep in two adjacent twin beds.
Yeah. Now it's like, well, none of those taboos exists anymore. So I guess like incest is the last taboo to like mm-hmm. confront in porn. So I'm guessing that played a role for your brother.
Could have. Who knows?
Yeah. I don't know. I'm speculating here. But anyway. Okay. Next confession. Hey guys, you are definitely my number one podcast, and I want to thank you for getting me through shifts as a hotel housekeeper. No, I Ooh. Haven't found any dead bodies.
God, yet. That was immediately going to be the question.
Stick with it long enough.
Kenyon's question on the last GAC, and this is from however many months ago, so from a past GAC, about whether or not you can die from constipation made me realize that I just might have a story for you guys.
Also, you deaf can.
So about 10 or 9 years ago when I was in 5th grade, my stomach started to hurt very badly. Now, when I was younger, up until I was about 8, I had an extremely sensitive stomach and would throw up after every meal. So when my stomach started hurting, my parents didn't think much of it. Besides, I had just started my period a year before, so it might have been cramps. And of course, I, a 10-year-old, did not tell my parents that I hadn't pooped in a few weeks.
Weeks?
Oh, no. Baby. She's like, they're like that lizard.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
The poop lizard.
The poop mm-hmm. lizard. Oh, honey. Mm-hmm.
The days progressed until I was in so much pain, I didn't want to speak.
Yeah. Oh, no, honey.
Can't blame you.
My parents were extremely confused because it didn't seem like appendicitis either. So one day, my stepdad took me to the doctor, and after telling her what was happening, she decided to take an x-ray. I wish I could tell you that I kept the picture, but I didn't find it amusing enough back then, and I would draw a diagram if I knew how to attach an image to this.
I don't have an Uber phone.
I bet they submitted on the website.
Oh, that's fair.
Oh.
If you can picture the organs that show up on x-rays from the anus to the heart, the entire digestive system was filled with solid shit.
Sir.
To the heart?
It was nearly touching my heart.
No.
And
no,
no. And if I had waited longer, it would have reached my heart and caused a heart attack
Babe.
Or something and kill me.
No.
No.
So I was prescribed a bottle of cherry-flavored laxative soda from Rite Aid, and two Yum. Days later, I was no longer Yum. About to die.
Lucy.
Yum. Yum.
Dreams do come true. Yum.
Yum.
Treat yourself.
After that last sentence, I'm just like, oh, yum.
But don't worry, I have IBSD now, so I have the opposite problem. Thanks for the hilarious and amazing show. With love, Aria. You can say my name. I'm not shy about it anymore.
Oh,
what's
my.
IBSD?
IBS with diarrhea versus IBS-C with constipation.
Oh, wow.
I added D.
I have IBSD.
I have IBSD.
I mean, I have both, but mostly D. Mostly D's.
I have shit up to my heart.
You have C?
No, I'm just kidding. Yum.
Yeah. Yum. Oh, my God. Yum. Lucy, Jesus Christ. Luck.
Luck.
Lucy never says lucky. She always says
luck. Okay.
So?
Oh my God, luck.
Okay, next one. Quote, in 8th grade, I was not really popular, LOL. Each year, my school had a superlative fundraiser that people would pay $1 to vote for somebody to win in each category. I decided to take matters into my own hands. Since I was not popular, there was no way I'd win one because not enough people knew me, let alone enough people would actually vote for me. So they announced that they would be doing this a week prior, and I decided that I would do as many chores as I could to raise enough money to then vote for myself a yes. bunch of times because yes. I wanted to win.
Oh my God. This is like
this
that
is
recent,
Kenyan in
what is that
fifth,
recent
in
news
fifth grade.
Headline about like the mom and daughter who like committed fraud to yeah. so that she could win
the homecoming
like,
queen homecoming or something
queen.
Yes.
This is some like Rebecca Ann Lehman shit and
oh,
I love
I saw it.
It
on Twitter just because somebody one of you retweeted that's Rebecca Ann Lehman vibes mm-hmm. or something like that
mm-hmm. It's so good.
So I ended up earning about $40 and snuck over to the booth of parents in charge of voting, and I voted for myself 40 times.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did, honey.
Mind you, each winner probably had maybe 10 to 15 votes because there weren't that many people in my grade.
There's 35 people in their grade.
You voted more times than there are students in your grade. I fucking love this for you. I love this journey for you.
I could see the suspicion on the parents' faces, but I didn't yeah. care.
Yeah.
The week ended and they announced the winners, and I pretended to be shocked when I won my category.
I'd like to thank God.
The category
was her category biggest cheat.
The category.
She didn't cheat. She just biggest spender.
That's cheating.
The category was friendliest.
Oh, baby. Honey, no.
Friendliest. What? You go for the most milquetoast category.
Which she bought the one she thought she deserved. I respect that.
The end of the sentence was, which, by the way, I was not.
All right, well, I take it back, I guess.
I didn't tell any of my friends what I did, and I could tell they were shocked, too.
We know this bitch. She is not friendly. What is going on?
They took our pictures for the yearbook so I can always go back and reminisce about my dumb and pointless charade.
I love it.
She get caught?
No. Signed, Soup's not the friendliest girl of the 2008 eighth grade class.
I just don't think there's really anything to get caught for. You buy a vote. She
yeah.
bought a bunch of votes. It's not what cheating.
What she did is basically what the Supreme Court ruled was fine.
Right?
That corporations yeah. are people and money is voice in
there
politics.
There you go.
She is her own super PAC.
She's gaming the system
if
for
you,
herself.
If
most
you
likely
have,
to succeed in Congress.
If you have a problem with what this girl did, then you are against Citizens United.
Yeah.
Correct.
Oh, oh my God. She is ready for politics.
She's Lindsey Graham's granddaughter.
All right. The last one is just funny. Last summer, my husband and I were house hunting. Our realtor brought us to a house, and as we were touring it, I was first in line through the house. I was always excited to see the master bedroom and bathroom, so I made a beeline there. I walked into the bedroom, and there was a bed in the middle of the room, but the comforter was on the floor.
How egregious.
I ignored it, and my realtor, who finally caught up to where I was, apologized for it. A second later, I walked into the bathroom, turned on the light, and started checking things out. I then had a mini heart attack a moment later when a couple came out of the master closet, half naked, super embarrassed.
Well, Bill and I did not do this when house hunting. But I did tell, I did like, not, I guess I should say threaten, not tell, to shower in every single home that we visited so I could check the water pressure.
You wanted to bathe. You wanted to take a full bath.
I wanted both. I wanted to shower and bathe, but the showering is for the water pressure.
Yeah.
Mm. And they're like, you know you can turn it on and put your hand under it, right? And I'm like, not enough.
Either way, you did beeline for that primary bathroom.
Always. That's always like the first thing I'd check.
Sorry.
How deep is the tub?
I should have said primary closet. Okay, so apparently it was this guy's sister's house. He had no idea it was supposed to be shown that day. They shuffled out of the house as fast as they could after fighting about finding their shoes.
Oh, OMG.
Selling point, honestly.
Yeah. Oh, closet big enough to pork in. Sold.
I know they were porking on the bed. They just heard people hid down the stairs.
Closet. Yeah, well, and hid in the closet.
Closet big enough to hide in. Sold.
Oh my God. So fucking funny. But
put
yeah,
that on your Zillow like list of wishes. Closet big enough to hide in.
Sold.
I'm sure he was just like, yeah, my sister's house is empty. It's on the market.
You know, my God.
Yeah.
Yep.
Fuck yeah.
Anyway, so those
I support it.
Are the confessions this month.
Those fantastic.
Were good. Nice job.
We had some good ones. Mm-hmm. Juicies.
Juicies. All right.
Let's lock.
Hear a quick word from our sponsors, you lock.
It has been a long winter stuck indoors, okay? But warmer days are here. They are here. Spring is no longer coming. It has arrived.
Thanks.
So get ready to seriously. Get ready to shake off the winter gloom. Throw open your front door, your back door, any door will do. Let's get outside, people. I know that my partner and I are getting ready to revamp our backyard. And if your home isn't quite the oasis that you have always envisioned yet, you gotta check out Bloomscape. They make it easy to grow the lush springtime retreat of your dreams.
For real, Bloomscape delivers healthy plants right to your door, plus all the grow how you need to help them thrive. Find the perfect plants for your space, whether you've got tons of light or hardly any. Thousands of people have already upgraded their spaces with beautiful indoor plants from Bloomscape, including us. And now Bloomscape is taking it outside with their new outdoor bloom kits. I can't wait to try the outdoor bloom kits.
I'm so excited for these.
Mm-hmm. But I ordered a Chinese fan palm.
Gorgeous.
It came in this big old box. It was really well wrapped. Mm-hmm. And then I unwrapped it, and it was just this beautiful, healthy, exotic looking plant.
Mm-hmm.
Their prices are great. I would expect to pay something comparable at a really nice, like, greenhouse. But this
this comes with the pot, like the beautiful pot.
Yeah. I have, like a kind of a cement gray, beautiful pot that goes with it. So, you know, maybe in years down the road, if the plant's gone, get another one, stick it in the same pot. It's amazing.
Exactly.
Their website is gorgeous. They have so much information. You can kind of look around to find, like I said, they have plants for really low light spaces, or like if you just have huge windows, you can kind of search by like the needs that you'll be able to meet for these plants.
Yeah, you got your basement boys, you got your sunshine sons.
Yes, exactly. And their new outdoor bloom kits from Bloomscape are exactly what we all need right now. As Amanda said, it is the easiest, most convenient way to get growing. You can shop a variety of young plants, accessories, tools, supplies. It's everything you need to get your patio or porch springtime ready. Let me tell you, my favorite thing to do in the spring and summertime is to read my book outside on my porch. And having plants out there, it just
takes you to another world.
It really does. And Bloomscape will ship at the perfect time to arrive after the last winter frost, so your plants will grow healthy and strong. They know what they're doing.
Mm-hmm. It's the best. So get 15% off plant orders of $100 with promo code GALS at bloomscape.com. One more time, that's 15% off plant orders of $100 or more at bloomscape.com using that promo code GALS, and treat your oasis.
Treat it.
Like many of you, I have had to get very creative in how I keep up with family, friends, loved ones over the last now more than a year. It's a little wild. And, you know, we've incorporated all of these cool ways to connect digitally into our lives now. That's the new normal, to just use that cliche. And this is an even more creative way to do that. And I feel like it's even more meaningful than just your weekly video call with the family, you know? So it's never been more important to stay in touch with everyone in our lives. And thanks to Storyworth, I can feel closer to loved ones no matter the distance.
Oh, yeah. Storyworth is an online service that helps your loved ones share stories through thought-provoking questions about their memories, their personal thoughts. It's a fun way to engage with family, especially those you can't see in person, because we're all looking out for grandma and grandpa right now.
Mm-hmm.
Every week, Storyworth emails your family member different story prompts, questions that you would never ask over, like, a casual Zoom call.
Right.
Like, Like, has your life turned out differently than how you imagined it would? You know, what kinds of things have you changed your mind about over the years?
I love that one.
Just really probing specific questions that elicit a really interesting response.
Mm-hmm.
Storyworth has helped numerous families learn more about each other in profound, special ways. So I've said before, I did Storyworth with my grandmother, mm-hmm. and the stories that I got out of that woman, she's a very stoic. She was like raised in the Dust Bowl during the Depression mm-hmm. with like 1,000 siblings. She's led a very interesting life, but she's also just like a very unsentimental person. So she's not going to like come out with those stories on her own.
Right.
But let me tell you, this book that we have combined with the pictures from her life, it is just so fascinating to look at.
I don't wanna, like, really hurt, like, tug on people's heartstrings, but this is one of those things that I really wish I had known about, like, before my dad passed away.
Oh,
so, like, do it when you can. Like, get these stories when you can while your loved ones are well enough to have these, like, conversations with you. It's so important. Do it.
Do it. And after 1 year, Storyworth will compile all of your stories, including photos, into a beautiful keepsake book that is shipped for free. Like I said, it's so easy. And, yeah, you can make those, like, those books by yourself and, like, have, like, your own information and, like, family tree information and... That's all well and good, but Storyworth is unique because they do elicit those fascinating stories and facts mm-hmm. that you might never know, especially about older generations. They're just not that, in general, just that upfront about, like,
totally.
You know. Yeah, so Storyworth is absolutely amazing. You've got to give it a try.
This would be a really cool idea for, like, newly engaged couples, too, to, like, get to know each other and, chronicle their story, their own lives, and then when they met, and, like, that would be super cool to have as a keepsake, like, for your wedding.
I love that.
Just a thought. So give your loved ones the gift of spending time together wherever you live with Storyworth. Get started right away with no shipping required by going to storyworth.com/gals. You'll get $10 off your first purchase. That's storyworth.com/gals for $10 off. And treat your stories.
Treat them all. What if you could get world-class wine at an affordable price delivered right to your door in the safety and comfort of your own home?
Oh my gosh. What if? Well, you know that this is literally our favorite thing. So we're very excited about Cameron Hughes Wine, which has a very unique business model. It's really cool. So they source top-rated wines directly from the best wineries around the world. So typically what you're going to encounter is that, like, exclusive wineries will overproduce batches of product and then keep the official quantities low. Like, they won't tell you that it was overproduced. Like, they'll tell you it's small batch so that they can keep the prices high. It's, you know, it's a little bit of, like, tricky marketing that gets you to pay a little bit more for your top dollar wines.
They want to keep it exclusive.
Mm-hmm. But Cameron gets these wines and then keeps his mouth shut about where they come from and sells them under the Cameron Hughes label for a fraction of the price, which is a pretty cool practice. And a lot of wineries, like, will do this. And it's an awesome way for you to get incredibly top quality wine without having to pay $300-$400 for a bottle. Like, this is legit. It's amazing. So Cameron Hughes offers luxury wines at affordable prices. Cameron Hughes Wine is your personal sommelier, your personal insider, your personal wine buyer. Like, it does not get fancier than this. And they currently have the following available in limited quantities. And we've tried all of these, and I have to tell you, they are exquisite.
Mm-hmm.
So I recently drank the entire bottle without sharing of the Lot 747 Russian River Valley Pinot Noir. I love Pinot Noirs from this viticultural area. They are incredible. And this is a classic. It's a smooth, savory gold medal Pinot from one of the best producers in California wine country. They sell this at $16 a bottle. It's less of half that what you would normally pay for this wine under its original label at their tasting room. So, like,
that's
this
amazing.
It's the best price that you could possibly imagine for this incredible product. It's my absolute favorite wine right now. I need to order, like, 100 more bottles of it. And we have great news. Today, Cameron is offering a deal exclusively to our listeners. You get 20% off and free shipping on 3 or more bottles, and all you have to do is enter our code GALS, G-A-L-S, at checkout. So these wines are already an amazing value for the price, and today, you can get top-rated award-winning wines at incredible savings. Save that money, drink the best wine, try wines that normally sell at such high-end prices that you just would never even consider spending that kind of money on these bottles. You can do it for a fraction of the cost. That Pinot's $16. Are you kidding me? These wines are incredible and they sell out quickly, so don't wait. Get on it. Tell us how, Lucy.
All right. You go to chwine.com today to get 20% off the already great prices and free shipping when you buy 3 or more bottles. Just enter our code GALS, G-A-L-S, at checkout. That is chwine.com with code GALS for 20% off 3 bottles or more, plus free shipping. Great wine, great prices delivered right to your door in the safety of your own home. What could be better? Treat your palate.
Oh, treat it.
Okay, so this is my coroner corner. I got 2 pieces for us. This first one comes from Coven member Samantha Marco.
Marco Polu.
Samantha sent me this really interesting article from Neuroscience News titled The Preferred Jobs of Serial Killers and Psychopaths.
Love that.
Oh, which was written by Michael Arntfield for The Conversation. And I'm just basically going to read the whole thing out loud.
If podcaster isn't at the top of the list, I'll be shocked.
If what? Oh,
I know, podcaster.
We'll get to it. The startling arrest of the elusive Golden State Killer, a.k.a. the East Area Rapist / Original Night Stalker / Diamond Knot Killer / Visalia Ransacker, in what was arguably the most vexing and disturbing constellation of interlinked cold cases in American history, has raised more questions than answers.
Always.
One question is how a serial burglar, rapist and murderer could operate in so many jurisdictions simultaneously and, much like in the case of Paul Bernardo in Canada, ever heard of him, have law enforcement officials so myopically overlook the connections among his crimes in several different cities. Another question is, of course, how a police officer like Joseph D'Angelo, the accused Golden State Killer, could be capable of such sadistic brutality throughout a large portion of his brief and troubled law enforcement career.
Yeah, basically, turns out sadistic people are drawn to positions of
authority.
Yeah.
Big time.
I learned this in my human identity and relationships class that I took with Corey, who I'm now married to. It's basically our first date.
Was a night
class about how military and police professionals are more likely to abuse their spouses.
And he was like his entire family.
Yeah. You just took like a free adult education class as your first date. I fucking love that.
It wasn't adult education. We were in college.
Oh, that's fair. I forget that you've known each other for 1,000 years.
We've been together for like 16 years.
Yeah, I forget this. I'm sorry. My apologies.
I don't know why I apologize to you, but anyway. Similar questions have been raised.
Apologize to your husband.
He can't hear me. He has his fucking headphones on with his fucking video game.
Classic.
Oh, he did hear me. Hi, sorry. I love you. Similar questions have been raised.
Okay.
He just goes, I can hear you.
It's China.
Make me macaroni. Okay. Similar questions have been raised in the past about other serial offenders, killers whose innocuous and even virtuous jobs seem to belie the horrors they committed while hiding behind a veneer of respectability. That includes the infamous Canadian Colonel Russell Williams, who we've talked about before. I don't remember when.
Oh, who?
Maybe Canadian crimes. So he was the one who once piloted a VIP aircraft whose passengers included Queen Elizabeth. Remember?
I don't remember this.
Wait, say that again? What?
Colonel Russell Williams,
It's not rustling up any memories for me.
I think he was Canadian crimes. He was like a highly decorated military official who like evidently flew a bunch of rich, fancy, famous people around, like Queen Elizabeth.
Oh, he was the pilot. Yeah,
he was the pilot. He's the colonel.
Yeah, that's ringing a vague bell. I'm pretty sure it was my case, and it's only ringing a vague bell. So that tells you a lot about my memory.
We've also done a lot of episodes.
Yeah. Give yourself a little bit of grace. I'm not super into giving either of you grace, but like for this situation.
It's not my favorite thing to do.
That's not my go-to response, but like this time I'm going to say, you're good.
Okay, so from that guy to lesser-known computer store owner and prominent Nashville businessman Tom Steeples, who killed three people just for thrills before dying by suicide while in police custody. But in fact, occupations and serial murders are often linked, and some specific full-time and part-time jobs are strangely overrepresented among serial killers. So much so, in fact, that over the last 50 years, some dominant patterns have emerged. So let's break those down. Mm-hmm. Also, my throat is getting scratchy, and I don't know if it's just a psychosomatic thing because of Amanda, but I also got my vaccine. My first vaccine shot today.
Telling you, it's Zach, real.
I didn't have that, but Zach had a like scratchy cough for a while after both doses. So I think it's
hard legit. To tell also because I'm doing that kitchen remodel and my house is just full of dust. So
that's also true.
It's what it's. We're powering through. So for serial killer job breakdowns, I don't fully morally agree with these categories in terms of like skilled or semi-skilled or whatever. But that's how this particular author broke these down. So,
okay.
Your top three skilled serial killer occupations are an aircraft machinist or assembler.
Scary.
A shoemaker or repair person.
Oh, bizarre. That freaks me out. Yeah. Just a psychopathic shoemaker?
I'm writing that down. This is worse.
For your next novel.
The third one is worse, an automobile upholsterer.
That, like, makes sense to me, though. I don't find that worse than the shoemaker. There's something about
shoemaker
the shoemaker.
Knows, like, the size and shape of your feet. They know too much.
The automobile upholsterer.
Girl,
that's
you've
a handy
never
skill.
Sold foot picks, obviously.
Nobody wants my foot picks.
That's accurate. You have many beautiful features, and your feet are not one of them.
No. But I do send both of you pictures of my plantar wart.
Yeah, I know.
You
this
sure
is how
do.
I know this.
This is where I'm basing my authority on the subject.
Yes.
She's going correct. Strong.
God. Damn it.
Corn strong.
Wartamina.
What? Oh, no. No.
Your beauty is spread by word of mouth.
Wartamina. Plantarginate.
Oh. My God.
So our top three semi-skilled serial killer occupations are forestry worker or arborist.
Creepy.
Truck driver. Hi, we've been over that. Or a warehouse manager. And then
Daryl Philbin.
Don't disparage Daryl.
No, I wouldn't. Daryl is incredible.
Top three unskilled serial killer occupations are a general laborer, such as a mover, a landscaper, whatever, a hotel porter, or a gas station attendant. And then the top three professional or government serial killer occupations are police or security official, shocking to nobody, military personnel, also shocking to nobody. And religious official.
Yeah.
So obviously not everyone occupying these jobs is a serial killer, nor are they likely to become one. But there is something about these jobs that is inherently appealing to offenders or that otherwise cultivates the impulses of serial killers in waiting.
Yeah, exactly. Like we're not saying that like
these people are more prone to being serial killers. We're saying serial killers. They're more drawn to
these jobs.
Yeah, prone to these jobs. Yeah, exactly.
And causes them to be curiously overrepresented among this rare breed of murderer. Joseph DeAngelo, the alleged Golden State Killer, who like
he's been
fucking
convicted
is
now,
the
so.
Golden State Killer.
Yeah, so this is an old thing because he's...
It's not old. It's actually only from March. Oh. We're in March. Whatever.
Weird. Days ago.
This was published by the neuroscience thing like a week ago, but I don't know when it was published by the original article.
Mm-hmm.
Must have been at least a year ago. Anyway, DeAngelo, the Golden State Killer, for instance, actually held down three of these jobs over the course of his lifetime, which were police officer, military personnel, because he was previously in the U.S. Navy, and peripherally, truck driver, although his post-police career, because he was fired in 1979 for shoplifting, was spent mostly as a mechanic for a fleet of grocery store freezer trucks.
So he was a mechanic and a truck driver. He was ticking off all of
and
these boxes.
And a cop and a military person.
I know. Ooh. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And
he also loved to tend his little garden.
Ew.
And DBK was like, I mean, he wasn't one of the things on this list, but I feel like very similar in
BTK?
Like a.
BTK?
Yeah. And like a, he was like.
Yeah, he was like a super family man. He had like a, actually, we'll get to him. We'll get to
Dennis
Rader.
I feel
like
he's creepy enough to be a shoemaker.
I think there is a mention of Dennis Rader.
He was like an electrician, kind of.
Yeah, we'll get to him, I think.
He worked for like the energy company.
But this gets like more convoluted because as we go through the 20th century, our jobs, the whole format of our jobs are changing as technology like becomes more ubiquitous. So a closer look at these occupations reveals a bygone era in terms of available jobs, occupations that while once common and accessible to killers in the 1960s, 70s, and 80s are now largely obsolete. The job market is changing, and with that, so is the disturbing but legitimate nexus between murder and labor. The shift toward a service-based, tech-driven, and typically contractual economy, what is often called, quote-unquote, precarious work, which sounds great for, like, our generation, right?
Yeah, we're very familiar.
With precarious work.
It's all precarious, Dad.
Well, if you don't realize that this, what you're listening to right now, is held together with, like, duct tape
anything
and
more
dental
than shoestrings,
yeah.
Twine.
Let me tell you.
Yeah. Okay, so the shift towards a service space, whatever, along with the disappearance of once traditional career paths, will obviously have profound effects not only on the jobs held by offenders, but also how they acquire their victims. So serial killers once used the guise of their employment to stalk and acquire specific victims or types of victims. But new research suggests that leisure activities like music, including online interactions, may be the new avenue through which serial killers troll for their victims. So something that I cut out of this article just because I didn't quite understand it, but I will mention it. There was a influx in the, I think like the 70s, 80s, 90s in Nashville of like modern country music. So there were all of these new country bars that were opening up. Mm-hmm. And that's where like several serial killers started hunting for their victims. It's just based on like kind of pop culture shifts in a lot of ways.
Instead of like the bar on the corner where everybody knows everybody. So you couldn't really like get away with like being under the radar to like prey on victims.
I think a new
bar where there's always like different people around and you're kind of anonymous.
Yeah, it kind of boils down to just like societal shifts, really. Mm-hmm. It's not about occupation necessarily, but this article is about occupation, but it also opens the door to not being about using your vocation to either commit crimes or target victims or get away with those crimes. But it's just like a change in your in overall lifestyle and like where potential victims are attracted to, as country music bars.
Well, I could see that too. Like, think about it in terms of like
if you have a job that involves interacting with customers, say like a BTK, you know, going to people's houses to like service whatever.
Whoa.
If you're creepy, like if you're a serial killer,
which
like,
I am,
part of that, you're gonna be creepy at times.
Love.
People are able to then like report that back, and then you can easily be replaced with somebody who like is less creepy to interact with the public. Like you're very disposable and it'll get back to you. It'll have repercussions, whatever. And it's much easier and you have more anonymity to find victims online through like Tinder or whatever. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. So like this more like globalization, like bigger companies equals more accountability for those specific individuals. So now they're kind of retreating into the sidelines of like not necessarily using their occupation to find victims or to commit their crimes and like kind of going like down more narrow paths.
Although, have you guys been following the Sarah Everard case? I might be saying
Jesus
her name
Christ,
wrong.
I can't. Oh, that makes me ill.
I haven't.
Yeah, Amanda, you've been traveling, so you probably missed it. But this past week, as we record this, this young woman in the UK was walking home at night. And
she did every fucking thing she should have done.
Well, yeah, but even...
She was still killed by a fucking cop.
Yeah, she was raped and murdered by a cop. Ugh. And then the government's response was there were...
there's a curfew on women.
Basically, there's a curfew for women.
They blamed women.
There was, like, protests, you know, like, take back the night type protests. Mm-hmm. And police, like, broke them up violently and, arrested women.
Yeah,
and then the government announced that, like, more plainclothes police officers would be dispatched to, like, bars and restaurants and clubs.
Put more violent rapist / racists on the street to deal with the violent rapist who raped this woman.
Yeah.
Great. That
the violent
makes
rapist
so much
who
sense.
Happened to be a fucking police officer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I can't get into it right now. That's a whole can of worms. I cannot. I fucking
I mean, that is the rage that is always felt whenever it's like police reform. It's like, or, you know, anytime an incident like this happens, whether it's sexually motivated, racially motivated, and then their response is to like, or both, oftentimes.
No. And
like, their response is to, like, investigate themselves. It's like, they can't. The whole system is fucking corrupt.
You've had your chances hundreds of times. You've done jack shit.
The
your
system's
time
always
going to
protect itself.
It's not up to you anymore. Fuck you.
Yeah.
We're moving on. We're trying something else. Because obviously, you can't fucking handle your own fucking people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, because they are... That's why they say all cops are bastards.
Oh,
like, the system is built that way. So how is it going to fix itself? It's so fucking horrible.
All right. I can't. I'm sweating. I got a drunk dive to do after this. I can't blow my load yet.
Kick them back, girl.
Ugh. All right. Here we go.
Everything is dust.
The result is that we are likely to see returning once again to the alleged Toronto serial killer, Bruce MacArthur, which, like, alleged.
Covered.
Okay.
Yep.
We've actually covered Bruce MacArthur twice.
Is he really?
Yes, the
Santa
only,
crimes.
Yes, the only case.
Oh my
that,
God, we did
that. We've accidentally covered twice,
but very different ways.
Yes, true.
So, one was based around Santa and Christmas time, and one was because he's a fucking Canadian gardener or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yes, correct.
So we nailed it.
Okay, so the result that we are likely to see blurred occupational recreational categories involving both online and offline dimensions, a new paradigm that will force us to adjust the list of the most common jobs among serial killers. The caveat, of course, is that a single defining occupation is in continuous flux, as we've discussed, like jobs are constantly changing these days.
Right.
Could quote-unquote occupation, for instance, denote a primary vocation, a part-time avocation, or even just a paid hobby or pastime? Might it also include an unpaid pastime by which a person defines himself or herself? For example,
OnlyFans
shoemaker. I would define myself as like, an OnlyFans foot fetish model, a cat lover,
You're not a fossil collector. You're an aspiring OnlyFans foot model.
I wouldn't even say aspiring. I don't think she's ever going to cash in on that.
Is that a dare?
Yes. And I
just have to wait for the sun to come out so that I can tan my feet. The only reason I'm not posting pics of my feet is that my feet are so pale.
Don't post that shit for free.
I won't. I'm opening an OnlyFans. I just told you that.
Get a paywall, baby.
Oh, my God.
In MacArthur's case, we see that while he conforms to the general laborer category as a landscaper and not just a grass cutter, as well as the owner of his own company, he also fits no clear vocational definition. So he's like a business owner. He's a landscaper, yes, but he's not just like a day laborer in that sense.
Yeah.
Yes. He also had a military background, I think. I can't remember, even though we've covered him twice.
Yeah, well, it's not speculate.
He had a background as a mall Santa, so.
He was a mall Santa.
Something's off.
And yes, as we already know from the morbid mass grave recovered from a client's home on Mallory Crescent in Toronto, the occupation of the accused was central to his alleged offenses and how he reportedly disposed of the victims. Mm-hmm. So in that sense, it was integral to his apparent modus operandi.
Yeah, so, he was able to bury them in his landscaping.
So it might not have been like a triggering force, but it was a means to an end.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
like we have to figure out how to categorize that.
Mm-hmm.
So while many killers use their employment as a pretext to acquire vulnerable victims, obtain information, or cultivate violent fantasies for reasons we still don't fully understand, in MacArthur's case, occupation was the back end to his alleged crimes, not the inspiration for them. And another example that they say in this article, Jeffrey Dahmer once admitted that his work as a chocolate factory machinist awakened homicidal and necrophilic urges he had otherwise suppressed. What? I haven't personally explored that. It might have just been a function of his mental...
State. Maybe it's because as someone working in a quote unquote unskilled job, which I also take issue with those labels because I don't know how to run that machine. I don't have that skill.
Right. Yeah.
What is skill? Let's break it down.
The only thing that belongs in the unskilled category is the cop. Okay. There I said. Easiest fucking job to get.
Okay. Oh so I'm thinking that, you know, unlike somebody who has to like respond to emails all day and like think about what to say and like not piss people off and, you know, make sure you say, I hope you're having a happy Monday. All that shit.
We don't say that to our fans.
No, but I have to deal with like
Kenyon
corporate.
Sells our ass.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She
does.
She has to say that.
Yeah. I have to say all that shit. So I don't know. Maybe like you have less time to like have these fantasies all day long
if it's a really like monotonous, mindless, muscle memory
repetitive,
sort of job.
Yeah, your mind can wander.
Your mind can wander.
Right.
And maybe you also feel frustration with your status and where you are in life. And maybe you're having like angry leading to violent thoughts. I don't know. I don't know.
I'm speculating, but that is my theory.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So what about psychopaths? As we begin as we begin to redraw the map of serial murder and career paths, it might also be useful to look at the otherwise better known index of occupations overrepresented among psychopaths. Mm-hmm. So lest we forget, not all psychopaths are serial killers.
Or violent.
Mm-hmm. Or violent. You probably know 10 psychopaths in your
literally
life.
Literally, like, being a doctor is such a good position for being a psychopath.
Oh, we'll get to it.
You can emotionally separate when you're cutting into somebody.
Yeah.
We'll get to it.
Yeah.
So psychopathy, or at the very least, the possession of psychopathic traits, because, again, those aren't the same thing necessarily. Mm-hmm. Is a common denominator among serial killers, sex offenders, and most violent criminals. So here are the top 10 occupations according to an Oxford University psychologist. So number one, a CEO or business executive.
Yeah, called it.
Mm-hmm. A lawyer. Hi. Mm-hmm. You have to have such a strong, like, separation of the self.
Mm-hmm. Well, imagine you are a public defender. Like, imagine how difficult it would be to see your client, like, to put in, obviously you want a public defender to, like, put in the absolute maximum amount of effort they possibly can with each and every client, but, like, it's probably not possible given their workloads, which is a problem of the system.
Mm-hmm. That's the, yeah, that's
not the individual.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And it's racist and misogynist and everything. But, like, imagine going home at night after working in that system.
Or, like, yeah. I think being a public defender might be the hardest job in the United States.
Or, like, a social worker. Like, oh, you, yeah. Your impulse is probably to, like, take every single kid that you think is at risk home mm-hmm. and nurture them. But obviously you can't do that on that scale. Mm-hmm. And so at some point you have to draw that line and draw those boundaries. And, like, that is yeah. heartbreaking. And I don't know how people do it.
Mm-hmm. As a... I would imagine that, like, to be an effective social worker as well as to be an effective public defender, there are so many cases and so many situations. Like, to do the majority of your clients justice, you would have to leave so much on the table just to preserve your work and your effort and your energy. You'd have to leave a lot on the table.
Mm-hmm. I just don't know how people manage it. And I'm sure there are some that are, like, I just don't know how, like, a really strong empath could survive. I just feel like you'd be so burnt out.
You'd have to be a psychopath.
Right.
But, like, in a good way.
Right. Right.
Yeah. My friend Josh, who is a public defender, is probably listening right now and, like, I'm not a psychopath. He's definitely
you
not
might
a psychopath.
Be, well, you might not be a psychopath, but you might have psychopathic traits.
I'm just
and that's
that
okay.
I'd be curious to ask him more about this because... I've known him for a really long time, and so I would categorize him absolutely as an empath, and I'm sure that he struggles in his job
maybe
a lot
of the time.
Maybe he
wishes he was a psychopath.
Maybe, but he also, like, continues on this path of work he's actually making a difference in his clients' lives, and it's yeah. not, and I mean, he's not a rich man. You don't get rich being a public defender. Like, that's right. not why he's doing it.
Right.
But
I just
yeah,
that was a bad
really
example,
hard.
But I was just trying to talk about, like,
I think yeah. that would take a lot of compartmentalization and a
it does.
Lot
and those are skills
of
that,
emotional energy. So
those are
how
skills that you
he
can
doesn't
learn.
Get fully fucking exhausted and wiped out, I just, like, okay.
Well, yeah,
God bless
and
them.
It's like why they say that therapists should always have a therapist. Like,
right.
you do soak, like, people in these positions do soak in a lot of secondary trauma.
Right.
And you have to have boundaries and you have to have resources to heal yourself so that you continue to effectively do your job. Right. And I think if you're willing to put energy into that internal work, then you can sustain. But there have to be days that are just fucking horrible. I can't even imagine.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So moving on and also looping back to what Amanda said about being podcasters, media personalities.
Done.
Nice. Number
I'm
three.
Like, technically, we're CEOs. We're definitely media personalities.
We're two on this list so far of three. Yep.
Salesperson, that makes four.
Me,
or three.
Three.
I'm three of four. Oh, no.
I mean, all of us definitely work in sales in this job.
Right.
A little bit. Surgeon.
All right,
nope.
That's a no. But yes, Lucy's secretly a surgeon.
Yeah, Lucy did dissect a pig, so. Mm-hmm.
I haven't done it yet because my kitchen's been torn apart. And my husband hasn't been home long enough to help me with it.
She says louder.
Yeah, louder mic. And facing away from the mic to scream through the door at her husband. I love it.
A journalist or a news anchor? A little
check.
Bit. Okay.
A little bit. We're bad journalists.
A police officer. Not shocking whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
Again, a religious official.
Mm-hmm.
A chef. Oh, my God.
Oh, no.
I read that as chief when I skimmed it earlier, so I didn't text Corey immediately. Now I have the hiccups. Great.
Nailing it.
And then followed up by miscellaneous civil servant, which would include military, city council, corrections, whatever.
Yeah, a lot of that hodgepodge of...
Yeah. So in overlaying these two lists, we can see that even amid a perpetually changing economy, certain jobs are always likely to appeal to those we will later be stunned to learn killed their entire family.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or managed to carry on that type of work while also being monsters in our midst.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Mm-hmm. So always be wary of those people.
Yeah. I mean, I think the police officer thing makes a lot of sense because it's also like hiding in plain sight and also that position of authority. Yeah, people are not.
Cops and military, it's all about it's an authority complex, just straight up.
And you're just not likely to be like questioned, really. And you have so many systems in place to protect you, including like your comrades.
And we have access to weapons.
We also have
to coerce people.
We also have such a culture of like worshiping a hero. Like we always have heroes, and like firefighters are our heroes, and cops are our heroes. It's like you can't
have no issues with firefighters.
You can't put an individual on a pedestal. Like let's just it's fucked up.
Mm-hmm. Well, and psychopathy often comes with narcissistic personality disorder.
Oh, right. So then they fucking love that hero worship. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And my ex was also ex-military.
And
loved to brag about it. And I was like, you sat in a bunker and didn't do shit.
Yeah, DJ was left off this list, but that is a glaring
discrepancy. DJ. Failed SoundCloud DJ.
That DJ. Okay.
Add it to the list.
Ew. Look, I'm adding DJ.
She's typing it in on her notes. DJ. She's a right race. Now.
She's a racing chef.
No, she's not. She's leaving it.
It's number 11.
I love it.
Thank you. It's if you're a DJ and your name is redacted.
Beep. Yep. Then yes.
Okay. Rounding us out with my obituary area.
So
a lot of amazing people send in this obit. So thank you to everyone who did. I didn't have time to tally up all your names, but it was like a fucking lot of you. So thank you. Okay, here's the obituary. This is for Eric A. Souser, a.k.a. Super Dad, a.k.a. Easy. Just a rocking dude from Omaha, Nebraska. Eric passed away peacefully in his sleep on Friday, February 26th, 2021, at the age of 43, with his wife by his side.
So young.
Also, quick interjection. One of the people who sent this in is from Australia. And they saw this article on like their daily news website, like really not reliable.
So this has
like
gone
fake
far.
News website. Yeah, but they wrote in this is a obit from NE in the USA, wherever that is.
Oh my God,
could
that's
be
how I
anywhere.
Felt.
Anywhere,
this is Nebraska.
So I felt addressing all those Valentines that went to like different like provinces in Canada. I don't understand.
Oh, yeah.
City and state.
Absolutely.
I don't get it.
NE is the state of Nebraska. God bless you. Okay, back to the obit. His departure was just in time for him to make his spiritual appearance at every Red Sox spring game.
Oh. Wow.
Eric is survived by his wife, Crystal, and three children, Amelia, Violet, and Benjamin.
Oh, so names. Cute.
All of whom will likely sleep in the same bed for many years to come. Sorry, Eric.
Oh.
He is also survived by his loving and caring parents, Ronnie and Paula Souser, and his sister and aunt extraordinaire, Jessica Souser. In addition to his immediate family, Eric leaves behind an incredible extended family and many, many friends. He is preceded in death by billions.
By all of humanity who
by
died
before
him. By
everyone else.
By the vast majority of humanity, including his dog, Harvey, who most of us love to hate.
Oh, no.
Oh,
no.
I love he's preceded in death by billions.
That is so good.
I want that in my obituary.
Okay. Done. I'm making a note.
Don't church it up. A lot of people have died before me.
Oh my God, I'm writing don't church it up.
And a lot of people will die after me.
Don't church it up is definitely going in your obit.
It's so good. I like how Canyon's writing my obituary.
Oh, right. Yeah.
I'll definitely die before you, but I will have already written your obit.
1,000%.
That's fair. I think we should all honestly, write each other's obits.
I agree.
Honestly.
Yeah.
I agree.
Let's
we should all take
in a couple months when we meet up after we're all vaccinated. We yes, have please. A reunion planned. I'm so fucking excited.
Oh, yeah. My God. All of us doing a craft night where we just write each other's obits.
That would be so fun.
Done. I'm adding it to the itinerary.
Add it to the itinerary. I know one person who is going to be resistant.
I have shirts. I have
oh my God.
I have a menu planned.
This is a retreat.
It's a
full-blown retreat.
It's a fucking retreat. Okay.
Oh, I'm so excited.
We are confident they are joyfully reconnecting right now, meaning Harvey and the deceased.
Mm-hmm. Not all of us as friends writing each other's obits.
No, not yet. Soon. If you knew Eric, you knew you were loved, and there's a good chance he told you that. Probably sober, maybe not. During his time here, he found a way into everyone's heart. Eric loved, in this order, his smoking hot wife.
Yes.
His brilliant kids and family, his many friends, the Boston Red Sox, the Kansas City Chiefs before being a Chiefs fan was cool, the Huskers, Liverpool football, QT iced tea, meaning Quick Trip iced tea, Adidas sneakers, fishing, backpacking, hiking, hunting, and any old Chevy he saw on the road.
Oh. Oh my God. Yes.
Eric hated sad stories, beats, romantic comedies, a snowpack driveway,
Fair.
And turning off the garage light. Mm-hmm. I have a feeling that was Crystal's addition there. That's it as far as things he hated. That's so cute. Eric was content with most everything else. We're not positive, but we think the cause of death was either leukemia or more likely being dead sexy.
Oh, I love it.
Eric, we've always loved you and miss you already. So then they give some information about the funeral. Admission is free to all who attend this once-in-a-lifetime show for the greatest man on earth. Following the service, the family requests jamming out to Ozzy Osbourne and raising a cold beer, preferably Busch Light, in celebration of Eric's life. In lieu of flowers, please pray that the Huskers have a winning season or send a donation to the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society in Eric's name. He would appreciate either or both.
I would like in my obit that you say in addition to flowers.
Right. You want the flowers.
Please
meaning
donate.
You want the burden of your loved ones having to deal with the flowers.
I want
the
a flowers lot of flowers.
It's a lot of flowers.
Mm-hmm. It's a lot of flowers.
I know.
Oh my God. Speaking of funerals and flowers, though, I went to my first funeral in well over a year last week. Mm-hmm. And I forgot how to get dressed, even though there's a very specific dress code.
Yeah,
I,
that's like couldn't... the easiest dress code ever.
It like isn't. And then I get there and I get really anxious because I'm like, well, I was like in a group of people and we're supposed to do a specific thing and I can't leave until I'm supposed to.
Mm-hmm.
And it was in like a huge mega church, but there was like, I don't know, there was something about like the orchestration and the fact that I had to be there and had to be dressed a certain way after this long of not having participated in any sort of cultural rituals. It was weird.
It's a lot to get used to for sure.
I'm just going to make sure I have a set of funeral leggings ready.
Yeah,
at the ready.
I need some funeral leggings.
Because mm-hmm. not even a funeral is going to get me to put on real pants, my friends.
Mm-hmm.
I wore leggings, but I also haven't dug out my lint roller in like 10 months. Mm-hmm. So.
You wore leggings to the funeral?
What did I wear? No, I wore my black, they're Spanx leggings, but they have like fake seams. They have the fake seams.
Yeah.
So they feel like leggings. But I haven't worn them in so long that now they're really tight, so I still felt nauseous the whole time.
Yep.
Transition
leggings.
So
they were basically pants.
Well, I mean, the only thing worse than your discomfort at this funeral is
the death.
The man. Yeah. So there's a little dose of
perspective. I don't
know.
My discomfort was intense.
Up there. All right.
right.
Jesus fucking Christ.
All right. Well, that's our show. Thank you for tuning in. We'll talk to you next week.
See you next month.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening to Wine and Crime. Our cover art is by Kala Yip. Music by Phil Young and Corey Wendell. Editing by Jonathan Camp. Check out our website and blog at wineandcrimepodcast.com. You can also follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Wine and Crime Pod. If you have questions, answers, or recommendations to share, email us at wineandcrimepodcast@gmail.com. Episodes are available on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Google Play, basically wherever you get your favorite podcasts. And if you like the show, please rate, review, and subscribe on Apple Podcasts. It is the best way to spread the word. If you'd like to show your support and get a shout out on air, visit our Patreon page to keep this podcast and the wine flowing. Cheers!